Alright, this is the curriculum and instruction meeting for January 22nd. In attendance are myself, Kristen Thompson. You guys want to go down the line? I don't know. Beverly? There we go.
Valerie Beverly?
Beverly Albright?
Angela Owens, I don't know if everybody else is next.
Alright, and first on the agenda is district data summary.
So, this first item on the agenda, I'm just gonna do a little quick presentation. And it's that time of year where we go over the district-wide data for the 22-23 school year. So we're going to be looking at our ELA achievement, our math achievement, and our science achievement. And we're going to be looking at the achievement data from the state tests. So the PSSAs, those are the tests that are taken from third to eighth grade in ELA and math. And then in science, the PSSA is taken in fourth and eighth grade. The keystones, those are taken at the completion of a course. So in our case, we take it at the completion of English 10, Algebra 1, and Biology. And so those scores also, when a student takes that test, it's banked until their 11th grade year. And what that means is if they take the test, the keystone in 9th grade, and they get proficient or advanced, it's banked until their 11th grade year, and that's when it's reported. The keystones are a graduation requirement. So we do everything in our power to have the students proficient or advanced in those keystones. There are other pathways that students can take, but that is the pathway that we want our students to be successful in. So again, this is a very broad overview of the district. We're not getting down to the nitty-gritty of each grade level and things like that, but right here is our ELA achievement. And this is a comparison. If you look at the bar graph, the blue is us. The orange is the state, the green is the county, and the yellow is peer schools. And in this case, the peer schools are Pennsylvania Public Schools, who are in our same economically disadvantaged, so 30 to 40% economically disadvantaged. So in this case here, you can see that we are slightly above the county and the state average. And in the PSSAs, we are a little bit below our peer schools, and in the keystones, we're a little bit above. So our kids are definitely leading us well prepared in ELA. This next slide here is basically just the PSSAs. So it's the same information we look at there, but this is broken out into the PSSAs. As you can see, we had a slight incline, we're the blue again. Slight incline in 21-22, and then a little bit of a decline in 22-23. And again, I know we've mentioned it a lot in different committee meetings, and we want to bolster our MTSS model so that, you know, we're meeting kids where they're at, we're filling in those instructional gaps. Also, what I noticed here is we did start a new program in ELA, so sometimes when schools start with new resources, until the teachers and the students kind of get the hang of it, you might see a decline in some of the achievement until they get to swing things. Alright, so now we're at the ELA, the keystones. So again, this is after English 10. And as you can see, the steep decline between 2019 and 2022. And of course, that's reflecting the pandemic. But again, the main way to battle through this is through our MTSS model and enhancing what we currently have. We're also looking to tighten up our curriculum, something we look at on a yearly basis. We're always trying to make sure our curriculum's aligned with the Pennsylvania State Standards, what the kids are seeing on the test. So now we move on to math, and again, consistently above the county and the state average. On the left, PSSAs, on the right, keystones. Again, we are in blue. This next slide is, again, the PSSAs, so just grades 3 through 8, and I think what's encouraging here is that upward trend. That's definitely encouraging. This is 2021, 22, 23. Algebra 1 Houston, that graph looks a little scary. But these, again, results are indicative of the COVID year and kind of that loss of instruction. And some of you might recall last year when I did a presentation on biology keystones, there was a waiver given to students in 2020, obviously, and that catches up to us. Again, those scores are banked until their 11th grade year. So what happened here? The 2022-23 results are still reflecting those waivers that were given. And so for Algebra 1, some of our highest performing students were given that waiver. Almost 100 of them were given this waiver, so we don't have the benefit of those results. The students that did take it either failed their Algebra 1 course and then were required to take the Algebra 1 keystone later, or they didn't take Algebra 1 with their peers and instead were taking it in 10th or 11th grade. So that's why that steep decline in keystone scores. Again, you can see that in everybody. Same thing happened across the state and county. All right, and now, again, very similar to other data, our science, we are trending above the county and the state, right along with our peers. And here is the PSSAs. Again, the PSSAs are only fourth and eighth grade. And now we're on to our biology keystone. Like I mentioned with algebra, last year is the year we had that big dip because of the waivers. If I remember correctly, that indicated about 45 of our students that took that. Again, the waivers were given, and that was most of our higher performing students. This is all the students that, for some reason, didn't take biology with their peers. I just want to kind of wrap up just to say that all that data, understanding all of that data, just brings us to some of our initiatives. And obviously we are going through the strategic planning, but our initiatives are definitely through our curriculum to solidify the curriculum cycle, to make sure our curriculum is aligned with the state standards and always monitoring that and how we're delivering that. Also, we want to make sure we're using research validated resources. And by doing all this, we really need to also evaluate our organizational structure so that we can really use our content area specialists to kind of take the lead on our curriculum. And as far as instruction, we want to continue bolstering our multi-tiered system of supports. And the most important thing in educating a child is building a relationship with that child, so we want to constantly work on that. And we also are working with our teachers through professional development to improve and increase our student engagement. Anybody have any questions? I know it's very high level, but. And again, our principals and our teachers are looking at this data as well and working through to be a little bit more honed in on their grade level or their content area.
So what are the teachers? I mean, we're below our peer schools. That's like concerning.
So I saw that too, and I looked a little deeper into that, and one of the things I saw was that, remember, those peer schools, the only thing we're peers about is our economically disadvantaged status, the 30-40%. The two things that I thought were interesting is, we have 39% free reduced lunch. The average of the peer schools was 35%, so there's a little bit of a difference there. And then also, you know, like if you look at things like our IEP status, we had a higher percentage of IEPs than the average of the. So, you know, data, all data is flawed, all data has a different story to tell. But all in all, I'm not too concerned about that. I think we're trending in a very good direction. And believe me, we have a lot of work to do.
We do. Yeah. Okay.
So just to interject, one of my biggest goals for next year is actually to put together almost like a state of the district that, you know, it would be something that I would be presenting about midway through this school year. And part of that would be on the budget, a budget update. Part of that would be on our strategic plan update, how we're doing progress towards our strategic plan goals. And then also part of that would be how we're doing academically and bringing as much data into that presentation as I possibly can. Again, just trying to increase our levels of transparency. And a lot of this work is to try to demystify things. Oftentimes, I think we try to make things a little bit harder than they really need to be, both with the budget process as well as with curriculum and instruction. At its core, we need to make sure that we have a solid curriculum, what it is that we're teaching. We need to make sure we have a cycle where that constantly gets revised. You need to make sure that resources that are available to the teachers are the right resources, ones that have proven to be effective. And then on top of that, we then have to take a look at our instruction, what it is that we're doing in our classroom. From tier one through tier three, you heard about MTSS, our multi-tiered system of support. Again, it's just fancy words for we need to make sure that we identify students that are struggling, that have gaps, and we provide the appropriate level of support for those that have a need. And we want to make data-informed decisions in that process. So we need to make sure that we're utilizing effective measures, universal screeners, pull that data out, have data conversations, use that to drive the instruction, and make sure that's done in a very systematic way. Again, none of this is rocket science. It's just about making sure that we have the right process and procedures together. So I'm very encouraged when I take a look at the numbers that we have here. Looking at some of that comparative data, being a competitive person, I really want to be top of the state, top of the nation in all things. That's the goal, right? It's not going to happen overnight, though. I have seen through my experiences, once you have those systems in place and you work collaboratively with your team of teachers, the sky's the limit. And we are sitting on so much potential amazingness here at Daniel Boone. We have great teachers that are doing fantastic work, but I can tell you, just from the conversations I've had with everybody, all of that work is not necessarily completely aligned. Some teachers are teaching amazing content, but it might be content from the grade above or the grade below. It's just not all completely aligned yet. And that's a big part of the work that we're looking to do. As we move through this, I am already confident, even only being here a semester at this point, that we're going to continue to see those numbers increase. But the hardest thing is that we're playing the long game, because it really starts at the youngest grades, providing the deepest level of a strong foundation, and then from that foundation, moving it on up through. It's harder when students are already at middle school and high school, where maybe they have some of these gaps, and maybe they're missing the foundational piece. That's when it's the hardest work to do. Not impossible, we're up to it, but once we have the systems in place, that is really when you start seeing the bang for the buck. But for students to work through the system, you're talking 6-7 years until you start seeing some of that really truly reflected in your PSSA data. And I will also go a little bit on my soapbox right now and also share that I personally believe PSSAs are flawed. I think Keystone exams are flawed. They're a one-time measure of student's ability. It doesn't matter if that student broke their leg the day before. It doesn't matter if that student that morning had a big fight blow up with their parents. That is the day that the student assessed it, and that's the data that we receive. I believe there are better measures of a student's ability, which are multiple data sets throughout the year. That's not where we are as a state right now, but I do believe that the state is recognizing some of the shortcomings of the current model, the way that it's set up. And I'm encouraged by some of the candid conversations that PDE is already starting to have. So I do think that there's going to be some flexibility in that in the future. But I do think it's also worth publicly stating that PSSA and Keystone exams are not truly the end-all, be-all measure of a student's success. We have seen countless students go through our programs, struggle with Keystone exams, but absolutely nail it when they get out into the quote-unquote real world. So there's a lot of work that we have to do, and this is one of the data sets that we do need to look at very seriously to make sure that we're doing what we can for our students. But I do just encourage everyone to remember it is one of the data sets that we look at.
Okay. Any other questions on that? Okay.
I just want to say that I agree that I appreciate the clarity. I think something that perhaps you could take into consideration is the literacy rate. I'm not sure if that's measured. Do we measure literacy and improvement over time? The only reason why I say that is because I was a very poor test taker in school. So if I were to take the PSOE to your point, it is a flawed, it could be a flawed test, along with the PSSAs, but it's not a direct reflection of how a child's going to progress through society. I think a large part of it for me is literacy. And something that I do sense that a lot of children struggle with comprehension and literacy, and that's something that can have dramatic or dramatic improvement.
So literacy is assessed essentially within that ELA, English Language Arts, PSSA, and then the Keystone exam goes along with that. There is legislation and also work that we're doing in the literacy world. Do you want to talk a little bit about that, Mrs. Owens?
So the structure of literacy, the state is requiring us to provide professional development for all of our teachers regarding science and reading, how students really learn to read, the phonics foundation in the early grades. So, and we're on that, and we are working on improving our literacy.
Yep. Actually, tonight for one of the voting items is the acceptance of the grant, and that is specifically tailored for literacy. We've done an audit so far, and then we're evaluating right now if we continue with a quasi-coaching model that again is all specifically focused on literacy.
All right. Targeted support and improvement.
Yeah, and I just put that on there just to improve transparency. Every year the state takes a look at the data that we give to them from our school with all kinds of data. And they have some benchmarks that if you don't hit them, they put you on something called targeted support and improvement. And then they make you have a plan to improve that. So we were designated as, it's called TSI, targeted support and improvement. And it was in one of our student groups, and in this case, it was our students with disability group. They fell below the threshold for our graduation rate. So the good thing about this is our data was flawed that we sent them. So we, luckily our high school principal worked with our director of special ed and with our PIMS reporting person and found out where we went wrong with our data. And they fixed it for this coming year so that this coming year we won't have to worry about that. We'll have everything right. And so there's that. There's nothing we can do about it. We're still designated this, so it is public knowledge, and I just want to make sure that you were aware that this was a designation we were given. The other piece of it was with our students with disabilities, the law states that when a student completes their senior year, they can stay with us till they're, it always has been 21, but now it's 22 years old. That's what the law states. When we do that, we report that they didn't graduate. So that reports negatively to us. And so the way we have to report it, I don't know why they would do such a thing, because it really hurts us. But we, of course, are going to follow the law, and it's the right thing to do if we are to educate a child in their IEP until they're 21, 22 years old, we will do it. So that's another reason that we fell below the threshold. Just wanted to let you know.
And just again, wrapping up the data piece, again, a lot of this is process procedure, so making sure that we have proper procedure for reviewing and evaluating the data before it gets submitted to the state. Is there any something we've taken care of at this point? So we do not anticipate issues moving forward. It was just an inaccurate file that ended up getting submitted, which is what triggered this TSI designation.
Okay.
That's
there any financial benefits towards raising the score, or if the score stays where it's at, does the school get more funding to improve the testing?
Great question. So just to summarize, the question is, do we receive additional funding or lose funding based on our student achievement on PSSA and Keystone exams? And the answer is no.
Anything else? Can I ask a question? I'm still very concerned about fifth grade. Is any update on how we're improving fifth grade at middle school?
Well, again, just like all of our grades and all of our schools are our interventions, and I know exactly what you're talking about. I'd rather talk about it with you personally, but she is asking about achievement in particular to that.
I mean, fifth grade period, like, I think the expectations we have on fifth graders is enormous.
That's one of the things that is actually the strategic plan that we are looking at too, is that transition between fourth to fifth grade, transition to middle school, having fifth grade more elementary feel to it. So it's definitely something that is on our radar, yes.
I was just going to say, one of the difficult things is changing middle of the year. So we are looking at everything from schedule to recess to potential playground, making sure that what we're doing in fourth grade mirrors fifth grade, so it's less of a transition for our students. All of that is stuff that we're currently looking at and evaluating moving forward, but that does not really fix the problem for this immediate year in terms of shifting the entire schedule around.
Have you guys made any decisions on what you're going to be changing for next year?
That right now is still in the strategic plan, and there will be probably ad hoc committees that will help be formed to make sure that we make an informed decision, including parents.
Can you guys elaborate on
what's going on for those new board members? Well, we moved fifth grade to the middle school this is the second year, yes. I mean, and I just have experience right now with, I have a daughter that's in seventh grade, and she went through fifth grade at the elementary school, and now my son is in fifth grade, and it's just a very different experience, and I feel like the expectations are a bit much on a 10-year-old.
I'll share
that.
I don't want to make this sound wrong, but it is almost like you took the elementary model and try to also morph it with the middle school model, and that's a tricky task to do, and I don't want to make it sound like anybody did anything wrong, but the middle school set up periods, right, throughout the day, they rotate at different times, and I would say the current model might have students moving around more than, you know, we'd ideally like to see a fifth grade student move around, but again, I'm too early in the process to come in and say this is exactly what it's going to look like and this is exactly what the schedule is going to be. But what we have been pushing this year is, remember those students in fifth grade are still elementary students. We want it to feel as much like elementary as possible, including breaks in the day and that kind of thing. I wouldn't say the outcome is extremely perfect by any stretch of the imagination, but those are the things that we're looking at.
Yes. We wanted to bring back full-day kindergarten. So we brought back full-day kindergarten. The middle school was wildly underused. So it made sense to move fifth grade there. Oh. Is that all? All right. This ends the curriculum and instruction meeting.